Ladies and gentlemen, we are landing momentarily. Return to your seat immediately. Sit down and fasten your seatbelt. Nobody love you like I love you, my baby. Ooh, one plus one is one. Now give me the melody, I'm gonna play it forever. Yeah, nobody love you like I do, my baby. You were waiting for my name, my baby. You didn't make me love. Yeah, now give me the whole plan of my baby.
I'm going to meet my dad.
Yeah.
I'm going to meet him. I'm going to surprise him. To see his reaction. Came all the way from Florida to meet him.
Yeah, it'll be okay. Rising. All right.
Oh my god, get on my
face. I'm on
big fat off. Oh my god.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay.
All of you guys look good. Masana looks exactly the same.
The same way.
We haven't changed at all.
The same
way.
Yeah, but I've been talking to him.
Need some distraction. Oh, beautiful release. Memories seep from my veins. Let me be empty. Oil weightless, and maybe I'll find some peace.
Years of civil war in West Africa, Morovia. For me, it's been over 20 years since I've been here, and we're going to be talking to a number of people, both family members, on their individual account of how the war has affected them, the impact it has on them and their family, and common solution. This is my journey and documentary recording of what took place in Liberia.
Don't make no difference. Escape when that's
we'll be right back.
to it.
We thank God for your
thank you. Thank you, Oma. Thank you. So how y'all managed to, how you managed to survive in a war? So how many days did that take you?
Huh?
To walk from Lofa County to back to Monrovia, how long did that take you? So what, 1 week, 2 weeks?
No, months.
Months.
But
like I said, you look so happy now that the war is back. So what do you think need to happen? What do you want to see change? In your own way, what do you want to see change? What do you envision Liberia as?
Right now, as we sitting now, after thinking about, I tell you that people will not hear the sound for us to be running. You know, if turn like that, we were running here and there. Again, that anytime we got the frustration.
Yeah, the stress will kill you. So what do you think need to happen for us, to the country, to get better? What do you think need to happen?
The only thing that I think now, we just have to pray to Almighty God and God.
So to be united, meaning don't fight each other, and just if you have one bowl of rice, share with each other, whether you be from food tribe or Lofa, we just sit down together. It doesn't matter. So what happened to your son? So they shot him when he was 1 year old? 1 year old.
He was standing.
Like a straight bullet. So what they have to do, cut his leg?
But it moved that.
So it got just blown away from his body at 1 year old. That's incredible. This is incredible.
Yeah.
So we're glad you have it. Anyway, nice to meet you, yeah.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance. For a break that would make it okay. There's always some reason to feel not good enough. and it's hard at the end of the day. I need some distraction.
From Monrovia, Liberia, in an area called Bonneville. And I want to talk to Wea about his account of the 14 years of civil war and what took place. Can you tell us what you remember in sort of a 1 or 2 minute narration of what happened in the war?
Yeah, the Liberian Civil War was so devastating. Bad, absolutely bad. I remember everything was out of stock when the war started, and you could see those AFL soldiers.
And what's AFL?
Armed Forces of Liberia. Okay. You could see them moving from one place to the other, asking you if they were to see you, you know, carrying a bag or carrying a carrying your food, they would ask for a receipt. And I still remember those days, they were bad.
And if you don't give them the receipt, what happened?
They would set you on the ground. And even to the largest extent, I remember knowing a fellow because he was wearing a uniform and I wanted to say hi to him and say, oh, my friend, what's up? He asked where I knew him from. I told him I knew him from New Crew Town. He got so annoyed and made me to sit in the dirty water on the main road. So everything went out of stock. You couldn't trust anybody. Things were bad up, no food. People died of starvation. I saw people, you know, swollen up, you know. Too bad.
How did you manage to keep your sanity throughout the 14 years of unrest?
Yeah, I had to keep my sanity, you know, based on God's intervention. They were bad. I didn't get sick because of my smartness. No, I got saved because I was always praying to see this day, and you know, so as to tell the story to my children and to my children's children. That's how God helped, you know, that's how I came to be saved today. But I didn't get saved because I was smart, because I knew how to dodge bullets. No, that's not how I got saved.
So how has it affected you? How has the war affected you personally?
The moment I see somebody carrying guns or people running, you know, when I hear somebody shouting, running here and there, I get reminded of the wars of devastation. You know, it still goes with me as a person.
Right.
So the war was falling like that was very senseless. It still goes to our children's children, the generation unborn.
Right.
Because there were bad years, there were years. We don't really remember why did the war come to Liberia. We still don't cannot recount why the war came to Liberia.
Right. So how do you suggest some simple solution in terms of quick fixes and long-term fixes? What do you suggest in your own way, in your own vision, what do you think should happen in Liberia in terms of us moving forward as Liberians?
Well, what I suggest is Liberians should open a new chapter, that is, pulling everybody together, not looking at, you know, not sectionalizing Liberians, not looking at others as being elite and the other people as being vulnerable. But we need to open a new chapter where every Liberian will be treated as equals, where their resources will be equitably distributed. That's some of the reason why the war came. The war did not come because of tribalism. The war came because the resources were not equitably distributed. Mm-hmm. So Liberians need to hold together and don't look at people as being, you know, common people, and don't marginalize people. People should be treated as equals.
Right.
That's how we should work together. Right. And we can move Liberia forward.
Right.
That's what I suggest.
Very well said. With that said, what do you think has happened since Madam Ellen Johnson's leave, taking over of the Republic of Liberia?
Human security in general terms should be one of the new goals. And that certainly will include justice, the right to feel secured, right to information, the right to know that they have an identity or national identity. They first need to know their rights. And that in itself may require some education. There are many people who don't know the provisions of their constitutions and the rights that are granted to them. So once you've taught them their rights, then you must be able to respect it when they claim it through the justice system. I think we've turned the corner. I think our many years of reform, economic reform, our many years of democratization has set us on course. There are bound to be pockets, you know, of failures and pockets of instability from time to time. Failure is just the other side of success. You know, failure can be a stepping stone. You can build upon the lessons of failure. Everybody now watches the indicators, make sure that they redouble their efforts and whatnot. So the sensitization of the achievement of those goals are now there almost in every country. And so that will make it easier for the new development goals to, you know, to be achieved, and to be achieved perhaps at a much faster pace.
Well, what I think Ellen has done is first and foremost, under chapter Article 15 of the Liberian Constitution, which states freedom of expression, freedom of the press, which serves as a fundamental part, as a fundamental aspect of our basic rights.
Right.
She has given Liberians free speech, which has been denied by all presidents in Liberia.
Right.
So Ellen considers, she always says that she put up a thick skin. She accepts criticism. She accepts the views of the people. Mm-hmm. She carries on development. She's not 100%. No, she's not 100%.
Mm-hmm.
But she's more than 75%. She's
right.
doing her best. And Liberians are realizing that Ellen is one of the best presidents. It's even the best president that Liberia has ever had. So Ellen is doing well.
What do you think her vision is, just from what you've seen her do since she took office, what do you think her vision and the future of what Liberia is going to look like, say, you know, 5 years from now?
5 years from now, Liberians, she has inculcated within Liberians, she has given us the thought of leadership. She has made Liberians to understand that development is key to any nation. It serves as a core, a fundamental aspect to the development of any nation, that is infrastructure development, human resource development, right, which she considers high. She holds infrastructure, mainly education, that is that human resource, the development of human resource. She has capacitated Liberians to the extent that Liberians today, those who consider education to be of no value, they go to school now, they know right from wrong, and the whole, sometimes you hear some criticism, but it doesn't mean that Ellen is not working. Right. Ellen is doing her best, and Liberians are moving forward. Mm-hmm. There's no Liberian who talks of war, no. What Liberians are concerned about right now is to build their structures, to build their lives, to rebuild their lives. Mm-hmm. That's what Liberians are opting for right now. So I work with the House of Representatives as a public affairs officer, and we do public relations so as to mitigate problems that representatives are confronted with from the public. We settle, we serve as damage control officers. Sometimes the people think the legislature as a bunch of corrupt individuals, but we disabuse the minds of those who say those things.
So the damage control officer, does that mean you're looking after the welfare of the government officials, or are you there to serve the public openly as one cohesive group?
We serve as conduit, that is, we serve as live wire between the House of Representatives and the public. Sometimes the poor look at lawmakers as people who will come and dish out money to them in their constituencies. Sometimes they look at lawmakers as those who will build houses for them, but they don't know, most of the people don't know that they are there to legislate or promulgate laws.
Understood. I'm doing this interview that where we come up with solutions as to how we're going to make this problem of being the fifth poorest in the world, how we're going to make it better, and some of the struggle that people like we are and other individuals whom we're going to talk to in future interviews on how we can fix the problem to move forward. Because Liberia has a very, very rich history in conjunction with the U.S. and I'm very concerned. So what I'm doing is just kind of talking to people and seeing what their feelings has been since the 14 years of war, and 95% of those feelings been very negative one, from the violence standpoint, psychologically, and all other aspects of life. And that's why I'm conducting this interview, and hopefully it will shed light on Liberia, and hopefully we can get some help from the international community for Liberia. Thank you.